What's up, guys? Welcome to another Q&A episode. I've been getting this question a lot lately. I mean, this is a recurring question on the channel for sure. Which prime lens is better? So I'll give you my perspective on it. And I realize that, you know, for starters, obviously not everyone, statistically speaking, not everyone who does wildlife can afford a big prime. And of those few, of that percentage who can, there's a small percentage of that who could afford both, because obviously you'd want to have multiple, right? Like we all would. So this is going to be tailored to anyone who's actually considering a prime, and it's going to be specifically tailored to, like, if you could only have one. I'm one of those people. I do have a big prime. I've got that guy right there, which is the 500 F4 Mark II. And that's definitely the only one I'll probably ever have. Or at least, I'll probably ever only have one at a time. So if you could only have one, and if you're seriously considering it, which one should you get? There's the 400 2.8, a 500 F4, or a 600 F4. There are other primes out there. I'm not going to consider those. I'm going to consider these three because those are the main three that everybody always asks me about, and those are the most popular. So for starters, I definitely don't think that there is one prime lens that is better than the rest, especially in terms of like what you're going to do with it and what you need out of it. I think that's pretty obvious to most people. I don't think if you ask any pro photographer, they're really going to say, oh, you have to get this one hands down. Well, maybe they will. I don't know. I can't speak for anybody else. But I certainly wouldn't tell you hands down, this one you've got to get over all the other ones. It's definitely situationally dependent. Everybody's background in photography and their style and their needs for photography are different. So we'll start with the 400. They're usually 400 2.8, and that is the biggest draw of that one, I think, is the 2.8. You know, when we're doing wildlife, oftentimes we're shooting before sunrise and after sunset. Those are typically great times for wildlife activity. And that definitely necessitates as much light as we can get. And the aperture is your first line of defense there, because that's the first way the light is coming into your lens, to your camera system. So having a faster aperture is the best. It's awesome. Of course, with that also comes depth of field. A lot of photographers want that shallow depth of field, and that's amazing for everything. Although surprisingly, when you move up to a big prime, you might find yourself stopping down more than you thought you would, because sometimes that shallow depth of field is not the greatest for your actual subject, depending on how close you are to your subject and how much compression there is and all that kind of stuff. Suffice it to say, I do actually stop down my prime to f8 a lot, actually, to get as much in focus as I can of the subject, but not always. But anyways, there's definitely times when there's just not enough light and you want as much help as you can get. So opening that aperture up, these big primes across all the brands, they're sharp. They're sharper than anything you'll ever use, anything you've ever used before. The 400 2.8 open, wide open is incredible. The 500 F4, the 600 F4 wide open, they're incredible. They're all very sharp. Even though I do stop down sometimes, it's usually only to get that increased depth of field, or the decreased depth of field, or whichever way you want to look at it. It's to get more of the subject in focus. It's never because I'm worried about sharpness. These lenses, I think all of them, I've used a fair number of them, especially in the Canon world. And I know that the newer Sonys and Nikons are just as good. So 2.8 is definitely amazing, and I think that's the biggest attractor to a 400 2.8. The biggest downside, obviously, is reach. For 400, it's tough to say if that's enough reach for wildlife. I can't tell you if that's enough for you, but for me, I can tell you, I do primarily shoot birds, and of those birds that I shoot, a lot of them are tiny flappy birds. And 400 is not enough. And usually, even for me, 500 is not enough. And I find myself most of the time, not only with my teleconverter on, my 1.4 teleconverter, but also even in crop mode. And even then, 1120 millimeters equivalent focal length, I'm still cropping in on that for these tiny birds, because just do not underestimate how tiny tiny birds are and the minimum focus distance of these lenses and your just practical ability to actually get close to these things anyways. The more reach, the better. And that's usually what will push people to the opposite end of considering a 600 f4 over everything else, because reach is king when it comes to wildlife, especially for tiny subjects. On the other hand, devil's advocate to that, the 400 2.8, most people will gravitate towards that because of the 2.8. It's faster than anything else. It's incredible. But being able to, because the 400 2.8s are, they're all just super sharp, that, and because they're faster, that means that you can pair them with teleconverters and you'll usually get really great results, assuming you understand the limitations of teleconverters and understand physics and heat haze and atmospheric distortions, all of that stuff that I talk about all the time on my channel. Assuming you understand all that stuff, you can get amazing results with a 400-2.8 and a 1.4 or a 400-2.8 and a 2x teleconverter. That really opens up the versatility, and I think that's the second biggest attractor to the 400-2.8 is the versatility with being able to add either or those teleconverters. Being able to give you like a 560 f4 or an 800 f8, those are very powerful options. That being said, if you know that you're still shooting predominantly smaller subjects or subjects that are farther away, then you probably wouldn't want to consider a 400 even with the teleconverters, because if you're always going to be having to have a teleconverter on, then you might as well just get the next step up, which would be a 5 or a 600 millimeter. Unless you know you really like to do environmental portraits with maybe the potential to get closer every once in a while. But if you like environmental portraits of small things in the frame and really showcasing how wildlife lives, because not all wildlife needs to be shown as portrait style images. I think a lot of people forget that. It's a great option, and I think it's great artistically, and there's a lot of great things about being able to showcase wider stuff and environmental stuff with wildlife. That is definitely subjective, of course, but that's just one of my opinions. I really enjoy wider stuff just as much as I do the tight stuff. If it has great light, great composition, and most importantly, tells a great story with or about that subject. In that case, the 400 is going to be awesome. All right, so let's go to the other end of the spectrum and let's talk about the 600 for a minute. So, on the other hand, reach is king, like a lot of people will say. That too is subjective, but usually when you go out doing wildlife, you're going to find yourself wanting more reach. And that's going to push a lot of people to the 600 f4. So that's the longest focal length we can get at an f4, which is fantastic. It's really great for low light still, because when you move up to something like an 800 f5.6, not only are those even more expensive, even bigger and heavier, but they're also slower in terms of aperture. So, you know, 600 f4, that's the longest you're going to get for a native f4. It's a fantastic option. They're regarded as some of the sharpest lenses ever made. You know, among all of these things, they're just fantastic. The downside is definitely usually weight and price. But if you can either comfortably handhold a 600 f4, especially the Mark II versions for the Canon, the newer versions, the RF version especially, and we're going to talk about those special cases here in a little bit, but if you think that you can manage hand-holding a 600 f4 for any length of time, or if you're comfortable walking around with a monopod or a tripod, gimbal head, however you think you can feel comfortable wielding a 600, then it's definitely going to be in the top options for any wildlife recommendations. I think the 400 2.8s have a lot going for them in terms of aperture and all that stuff, but I think that when most people think wildlife and when most people think I need to step it up and I want to get a prime, I feel like the first thing they probably jump to in their heads is definitely a 600 f4. And for good reason. I mean, they're an amazing lens, and that combo of like long length and fast aperture, you just really can't beat that for a lot of stuff. All right, let's talk about, I think, the redheaded stepchild, the thing that probably doesn't get as looked at as much, and we'll talk about the 500 millimeters. So not everybody has it. I don't think, does Sony have a 500 f4? I don't think they do. Not everybody may have a 500 f4, but Canon definitely does. They have a couple of them, minus the Mark II. Like I said, it's the latest version, or, you know, like 2011 or something like that, I think it came out. So it's been out for a minute. Definitely could use a refresh. Sadly, I don't think we're going to get one. But let me just briefly go over why I considered a 500, and maybe if you know your shooting style is anywhat similar to mine, maybe this will help you for something you hadn't considered. So number one, price. It's cheaper than both a 600 F4 and a 400 2.8. Number two, size and weight. So it is smaller than both the 600 F4 and a smaller aperture, obviously, like physical diameter, than a 400 2.8 or a 600 F4. It's lighter than both of those. For the Mark II version for the Canon, the 500 F4 Mark II is like a pound and a half, I think, lighter than the 600 F4, and somewhere around the same for the 400 2.8 Mark II. That's a decent size difference, especially if you're like me and you handhold pretty much everything you ever do. Taking that extra pound and a half off is very noticeable and very much appreciated, especially for my broken body. So another reason for me personally was being able to travel comfortably. So with the 500 F4, I'm in a unique ability to be able to pack it a lot easier, surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, than 600. And for all of those things combined, the price, the size, the weight, the portability, the packability, the hand holdability, losing an extra 100 millimeters, it was a risk that I was willing to take. It was a con that I'm willing to accept for the places that I want to go and for the things that I want to shoot. And personally, I've been really happy. I'm not going to recommend it completely, wholeheartedly, hands down, say, because I picked a 500, this is the best thing ever. I will admit that more often than not, I do miss the reach of a 600. I want as much reach as possible. I will also admit that I usually, 98% or more of the time, I usually have the 1.4 on the 500, making it a 700 f5.6. So having a native 600 f4 would be better for me. But the trade-offs, again, I haven't been able to afford a 600 f4 right off the bat. I mean, let's just assume that I could afford a 600 f4, the Mark II version, which is the same series as this one. Would I upgrade? The answer is probably going to be no, and it's going to be because of weight. I don't know if, for me, that extra weight is really worth the extra only 100 millimeters. I mean, 100 millimeters is a difference, but I think in most times with this, you know, with how well this does with the 1.4 teleconverter and or with being able to put it in crop mode on my R5, I don't think that extra weight really is worth it for me. And again, that's really specific to me personally because of my physical limitations, you know, all of my military injuries and just injuries over my life that were not military related. I just turned 40, so, you know, I'm not a spring chicken anymore. So that's just my life personally. I don't think the extra weight is worth it. Now, let's just talk about real quick the RF lenses. And the reason why I talk about these last is because obviously they're the newest, they're the best, and they are by far the most expensive. So I think that puts them out of the range of possibilities for a lot of people who could consider a prime. Like, you know, maybe you can come up with $5,000 to $8,000 for, you know, one of these Mark II versions, but coming up with, you know, $11,000 to $13,000, that's a big difference, you know. And That's a hard pill to swallow for a lot of people, including myself. Although it's in the back of my mind, and I am potentially, quietly, possibly long-term trying to save up for an RF version. That's my job. And I know my finances, and I know what I can comfortably do, and I know that it will probably be a very long time. So if you want to help me out with that, you can definitely take a workshop. The more workshops I do, the faster I can get one of those RF lenses. And if you come on the workshop after I get an RF lens, I'll definitely let you use it. And if you come on the workshop before I get the RF lens, you can use this one. In all seriousness, though, I have had a chance to use both the RF 600 and the RF 2.8 recently through very fortunate clients who were on my recent workshops. So a huge shout out to you guys for letting me try those out. And I can definitely say that it's crazy how the RF 400 2.8 and the RF 600 F4 are both very similarly weighted. And they're both, I think, just a little bit less, like ounces less than this 500 Mark II. They're both under 8 pounds. I think they're both around 7 pounds-ish, maybe even a hair less. And that's cool because I'm used to carrying that amount of weight with this, but the difference is a lot of their elements have been pulled back, so they're closer to the body, and that makes both the 400-28, the RF, and the 600F4 much more wieldable than even their previous versions, the Mark II EF versions. There are Mark III versions on the Canon side of those, and they're, for all intents and purposes, the same lenses as the RF, just Canon built in the RF adapter to the RF lenses. So optically, physically, everything, they're the same. And the difference for me was very noticeable. You know, like I said, I had a client let me use his 400-28, the RF version, while we were in Scotland shooting puffins. And I handheld that thing for a good hour or so without even just thinking about it. Even with this, I can handhold it pretty well, but I do have to pay attention. It is just slightly more front heavy than the RF versions, and so it does weigh down on you. And for me personally, just a little side note for you guys, one of my disabilities is I snapped this arm in half, completely in half, in the military. I had bones sticking out for like 4 days. I had many surgeries. I have a massive scar. I can't extend, you can't really see it on camera, but I can't extend this arm. It's, suffice it to say, I'm messed up. I can't feel anything. I have no feeling here. This arm is physically smaller, and that's my left arm. That's the arm that has to hold your lens out. So it's very hard for me to strength train. It's very hard for me to do very much anything physically with this arm for a long time. That being said, even with that and practicing good technique and having it close to your body and all this stuff, I've had very good results with the RF 400-28, and I was able to hand hold it for, you know, a good hour easily and walk around with it for even longer. And the same with the 600F4, it's just slightly larger, but it's still about like this and maybe even a few ounces lighter. The 600F4, I had no problem wielding, again, because of the balance that they did. Canon really, I'm very glad that they made those decisions and were able to bring a lot of those lens elements closer to the center and really balance that front end out. The lighter you can get that front end, it just makes such a big difference with hand-holding. So right off the bat, if money were no option, then I would tell you go for a 600F4 because it's lighter than this. And it's balanced better, and you know, 7 pounds versus 8.5 pounds, 6.9 pounds or something like that. I mean, that's incredible. If you're shooting a lot of wildlife that is of varying sizes, like if you go to Yellowstone a lot, you're shooting bears and bison and, you know, bigger animals like that, a 400-28 is awesome. If you're shooting a lot of controlled situations where you're in blinds or hides or whatever, and you know you can get a little closer, again, 400-28 is going to be your jam, especially if you can swing adding those teleconverters. Getting both teleconverters for the 400-28 is going to cost you a lot more money. If you're looking at the RF version, they're both like $500 or more, you know, so that's like another $1,000 for the teleconverters if you want both. If not, I would definitely say for all of these, whether you're considering a 400, 500, or 600, I would definitely say hands down, no matter which one you get, try to spend the extra money and get the 1.4 teleconverter. If you're doing the RF, you're going to get the RF one. If you're doing the version 2, the EF Mark 2 or Mark 3 versions, then definitely get the Mark 3 version of the teleconverters, whichever ones you get, because the Mark 3 are far superior. The Mark 2s are just, they're kind of atrocious these days, and I promise you will not be happy with the quality you get out of that versus the Mark 3. So that's my one big piece of advice, is no matter which one you get, definitely get the latest teleconverter that you can get for it. In the RF's case, it's the only teleconverter you can get for it. But if you're getting the EF, make sure you get the Mark III teleconverter. One more thing about the portability and the packability of these lenses. Chances are you're not always going to be shooting out of a car or, you know, really close to a car. Chances are if you're getting these lenses, there's probably times where you're going to want to hike, even if it's minimally, or get on a plane and go fly somewhere to a destination, like taking one of my workshops. There's 2 spots left for Scotland 2025 in May. You should be there. It'll be awesome. There's also a few spots left for winter bosque stuff if you want to come shoot cranes with me. It's one of the best experiences ever in New Mexico. Cranes, snow geese, winter raptors, ducks, it's amazing. So let's say you want to take one of my workshops, or you want to go somewhere and you want to pack your lenses. That's a big consideration. I have made a couple videos recently where I've talked about how I packed this one and how I modified my Shimoda 35 liter bag to be able to carry that. So if you want to check out that video, you can check that out. It might help you just see some packing solutions. The other reason that I opted for the 500 is because I can pack it like that and I can fit the hood in there too. I can take my Shimoda 35 liter bag with this 500 and a body and my 1-400 for super lightweight stuff and an extra lens and all of this stuff. I can fit all of that in my 35 liter bag, and the 35 liter bag will fit under a seat in all the normal airplanes. And that has been kind of a game changer, to not have to worry about putting in an overhead, to not have to check it, to know that you have all your stuff right under your seat. Like, that's kind of incredible. I did discover with one of the clients, 600 F4s, that we could fit it in my 35 liter bag, and it will fit also in the 50 liter bag, but the lens hood will not fit because it's just so much bigger. It won't, the back of the bag won't close. It's just too, you know, too big. So if you wanted to travel with something like that, you'd have to throw like the lens hood in like maybe your suitcase or something, or get like one of those lens hood, lens coat, the travel hoods or something like that, that can fold flat and, you know, you Velcro it around and it's like the foamy thing. So there would be like that option for both the 400-28 and the 600 F4, because they're both much larger diameter than the 500. And those are like little things to consider. But I think they're kind of important because, especially for me personally, is I do like to travel a lot. I there's a lot of places I want to go, and there's a lot of places I want to go with a big prime. And it's just, it's not to say that you can't. I mean, plenty of people will go to take their 600 F4s to Africa or, you know, to Alaska or whatever. Like, of course it's doable. I'm just talking about like, if you're either on a budget or if you're just super travel conscientious, this 500 F4 has been amazing for me for that. I've been very happy with that option and that ability to just travel a little bit lighter than you could potentially with the other two options. So I would definitely not rule a 500 out on the basis of, like, I know it's not as long as a 600 and I know it's not as fast as a 400. So that's why I said kind of like that redheaded stepchild. It's in the middle. I think people just kind of often overlook the 500s, but they're definitely worth considering. That being said, I still am saving pennies for probably, hopefully, eventually, the RF 600 F4. But that's a long time down the road. Like, we're talking like probably 5 or more years. But that's okay though, because I am really very, like, 99.99% happy with this right now. All right, so that's just some of my thoughts on 400 versus 500 versus 600, 2.8 versus F4. Hopefully that gives you some food for thought if you're in the market for this kind of stuff, and just really, you know, you just think about like how you shoot, what you shoot, where you shoot it, and put all that together with your budget and figure out like what you're really able to do. If you have any questions, if there's anything that I didn't go over or anything that I missed, if you already have one of these or looking for the other or whatever, leave those in the comments below. I definitely enjoy reading it, and it certainly helps other people in the community. If you made it this far, I really appreciate it. A couple of quick updates. I know this has been like kind of a lot of studio videos lately. It's been 5 weeks now since we've come back from Scotland. I still have one more Scotland video to publish. Camera Lady is still not recovered from being sick. It's been about 5 weeks now. She is mostly fine, but she's having like zero energy, higher heart rates, it's hard for her to breathe. And just doing stuff is just exacerbating her like way too quickly. So she hasn't been able to film a lot, and I've been having to just do a lot more, not having to, I've been, you know, just taking care of her and then, you know, our son and everything. So I've had a lot on my shoulders lately from a family perspective behind the scenes. It's been slowing the content down a lot, especially it's been slowing the content that I want to put out down. I'm having to do more of these studio videos. I do have some more stuff coming up pretty soon that'll be out and about. I'm just trying to figure out how to amend that a little bit to make sure that if and when Camera Lady comes back to filming, that we don't overdo it for her, and you know, we can ease back into that transition. So if you guys stuck with me, you know, for however long you've been with the channel, I really appreciate it. It means so much that you give me your time. I'm trying to do the best that I can for you guys. So hopefully we'll be able to get back out there pretty soon. If by some miracle this is the first video you've ever seen from me and you're still here this far, through all of the talky bits and everything, the personal stuff, man, I really appreciate that. If you want to go ahead and subscribe, that would be really cool. I have a lot of videos like this where it's Q&A type stuff where, you know, these questions come from you guys and I try to help you out. I've got editing stuff. I've got a ton of in the field stuff and a lot of different genres. So if this is your first time, check out some of the other playlists. Like maybe you'll find something you like. Stick around. I really appreciate it. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one.